Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullah. I am Professor Dr. Salman Khan, Pathology Department, SZMCRY Khan. My topic for today is aneuplasia. It is defined as the presence or formation of a new abnormal growth of tissue. Prior to this, we just go through the terms which you are already has been taught, but may be feeling familiar with many of them. Agenesis refers to the failure of an organ to develop during embryonic growth and development due to the absence of primordial tissue. Atrophy of the body tissue or organ is usually due to the wasting away, especially as a result of degeneration of cells or become vestigial during evolution. The calf muscles are atrophy is an example. Hypertrophy is the increase in the volume of an organ or tissue due to the enlargement of its components, mainly the cells. It is distinguished from hyperplasia, in which the cells remain approximately the same size but increase in number. Now, the hyperplasia is the enlargement of an organ or tissue caused by an increase in the reproduction rate of its cells, often as an initial stage in the development of cancer. Hyperplasia of the endocrine cells is also an example. Now, you have already gone through the cell cycle, but to have a better insight into the aneuplasia, how the cell takes the route of the hyperproliferative pool, so there is some dysregulation of the cells. You know, there is a very important checkpoint in the cell cycle known as G1S checkpoint. Owing to there is a dysregulation of this checkpoint owing to the mutation in the four genes which regulate the phosphorylation of RB genes shown in the right panel of the cell cycle. Cell cycle has got the four stages. G0 is the quiescent stage. The any cell which are going to be replicated as a part of the over daily turnover of the cells, they are just entering at the process starts from the G1, and G1 through S, G2 and M, the complication, the proliferation continues, and if the cells can has to restart the process again from G1, they can undergo or they can exit the cycle through G0. Look at the right panel of the hypophosphorylated RB genes. There are two phosphate attached to the E2 effectors, and if it goes on, so there is a transcriptional block in the S phase. So cell cycle is blocked here now. And then there is a hyperphosphorylation of the RB genes, in which the synthetic process continues and the cell enter into the hyperproliferative pools. So this is a normal phenomena which you have just seen in the cell cycle, already taught to one of our colleagues to you earlier on, but it was just a review to have an insight how the cells dysregulated. So there is a dysregulation at the G1S checkpoint owing to the mutation of one of the four genes that regulate the phosphorylation of RB genes. And you know the cell types, we have got the permanent cells that are incapable of regenerations. These are considered to be terminally differentiated and non-proliferative in postnatal life. And the cells include neuron, heart cells, skeleton muscle, and RBC, red blood cells. Labile cells, such as squamous epithelium of skin, continuously divide and regenerate. And same is true over the epithelia of the GAT also. Permanent cells such as neurons are unable to proliferate and leave the cell cycle. Stable cells such as liver hepatocytes have a low level of replications and can regenerate when signaled. So how the cancer cell become so? Cancer cell enjoy autonomy to some extent. How they acquire this autonomy? So there is a some characteristics which they acquire. One is the self-sufficiency in the growth signals. They are insensitive to the anti-growth signals. They have acquired the capacity to tissue invasion and metastasis. and limitless replicative potential, sustained angiogenesis. They can acquire their own blood supply through angiogenesis, and they evade the apoptosis. So in this way they are continually proliferating, and they are making their space into the tissues, expanding them. And if they are malignant, the malignant are usually metastatic, and all are metastatic, or some are locally malignant, which can just destroy the tissues in which they are formed. So we now come to the biology of tumor growth, how the tumor acquired their size. This is through the tumor cell doubling, clinically detectable tumor. So solid tumor is another example, clonal evolution of the tumor cells and heterogeneity. In the subsequent flow diagram, an image it will be easy to grasp it. The new subclon from the descendant of the original transformed cells. Progression of the tumor growth, evasion of host defense, and the tumor likely to be more aggressive. So here is the description now. On the left side of the flow diagram, so you just see in the above, a normal cell is there. A single tumor cell is found in the lung, upper lobe, almost in the middle part. So the red color is shown here, this is the tumor cell. The 30 doublings, and then size increases. So it's 1 gram to 10 raised to the 9, and then a clinically detectable tumor is just evident in the lung, and followed by the yellow arrow, which shows microscopic metastasis into the liver. And then the 10 doublings, and then this weight of the tumor is also 1 kg to 10 to 12 power cells. Maximum mass now complete is shown here in the lungs. So then is the metastasis in the liver, pinkish droplet drops. So what happens through the normal cells to the clinically detectable tumor, through the tumor progression and the tumor cell variant and heterogeneity? So how the cell get transformed? So this is through the chemical, radiation and viruses. These are the three stimulus which are going to cause the cell injury also, and they transform the cell. The neoplastic cells are the transformed cells, so due to the effects of chemicals, radiation and viruses mainly, and then they undergo the tumor progression. So there is a hyperplasia, and they acquire the potential to proliferate without responding to the stop signals. And proliferation of the genetically unstable cells. So genomic damage is usually there in these cells. So they are unstable now, and tumor cell variants and heterogeneity. So if you see the normal cell, transformed cell on the left side, the tumor cells of variable colors shown in, and these are the purple are showing the tumor variants, and pink and light pale are also there, and then others. Clonal expansion of the surviving cell variants. So how, what are the variants here? Non-antigenic are here, and then is the invasive, metastatic, and regenerative, and fewer are just reparating, requiring fewer growth potentials. So non-antigenic, invasive, metastatic, and requiring few growth factors. So these all constitute the heterogeneity in the tumors. And another diagram showing the same feature here now. And non-antigenic, invasive, metastatic, and requiring fewer growth factors. So with less nutrition, they are able to survive and replicate. So that's a phenomena which give them survival into the host, and then the metastasis also. So now it was just an outline about the neoplasia, and introductory how the cells are going to be replicating, and then they form a tumorous mass. So we are dealing with the one kind of benign lesions. So tumors can be the benign or malignant. So here is an example in the gross image showing is swelling below the ear of a man. So this swelling is hard and it's a benign swelling that turns out to be when biopsy is performed. So benign salivary gland tumor characterized by the neoplastic proliferation of parenchymatous glandular cells along with the myoepithelial components having a malignant potential. It's the most common type of salivary gland tumor and the most common tumor of the parotid gland. So initially it is a benign salivary gland tumor known as pleomorphic adenoma, but a malignant change can occur into this now. It can become a malignant one. And recurrence is usually common with this tumor, so this is a one germ cell layer derived tumor with diverging differentiation into the myoepithelial cell and epithelial elements. So myoepithelial cell fibromyxoid stroma is there, you will, and then is the epithelial dactylar fragments, and there is the chondrite and osteoid differentiation also in that tumor. So here is the microscopic picture, fibromyxoid stroma and the epithelial element arranged into the ductules and the synovium. So once again, the pleomorphic adenoma is one germ cell layer derivative, and there is a divergent differentiation into the other tissues like glandular tissues, fibromyxoid stroma and osteoid and the chondrite areas. Whereas a teratoma is a tumor which is derived from two germ cell layers or more than two germ cell layers. So they have got in the mature cystic form benign, and then it can be immature, the malignant one. So in the benign form, which is a mature cystic, there is a gross image showing the cystic cavity, and then is a mass with the hairs on it, and then there may be a tooth in that. So these are the benign features. And when you look into this histological image, so there is a hair shaft follicles and the epithelial elements, and then is the skin adenexa. So this is two or more than two germ cell layer derivatives, so having mature elements in that, so this is benign lesion, so it's known as teratoma. And it can be found in the tailbone, cerebrococcygeal teratoma, ovaries, testicles, but can also occur elsewhere in the body. Teratomas can appear in the newborn, children or adults. They are more common in females. Now we come to another tumor, which is a benign tumor, leiomyomas, of smooth muscle origin. So this is a very common tumor, and this can be put in the gross examination during the examination. That's why it's very important, and I hope you will be listening at it very clearly and memorizing it and repeating it. So look at this poorly circumscribed tumor, pale whitish in color, which is a solid one, and then this is a lesion which is poorly circumscribed from to solid, from to hard, and then is the microscopic examination. If you see, there are the smooth muscle cells with the regular nuclei arranged in whorl patterns. It is now the leiomyoma is shown here. So look at the nuclei, vesicles of the smooth muscle cells having regular nuclei, spindly cells are there. So any questions if you want to ask, just welcome.